story we need to tell. Are you okay with that? And I said, me? No. I'm absolutely not okay with that. I said, but I'll be really honest. I said, I sat in my car and prayed before I got out of my car today to talk to you, that the Lord would move aside Jennifer Friend and that the Holy Spirit would speak through me instead. So go for it. Ended up on the front page of the Register. So my entire family, as you can imagine, had people calling, and we'd lived here our whole lives. Oh my gosh, I had no idea. I didn't know this is, and from that moment, my life really started changing in what I would call my understanding of why my story mattered. And so I read Esther, and a lot of people talked to me about Esther during that time. And I ultimately knew that God was calling me to leave my law firm and to come and be the CEO of Project Hope Alliance. And so I did that in 2013. At that time, our total operating budget was about $686,000. We operated much more like a foundation than really a social impact organization, and we served 65 kids at one school. Today, our operating budget, just 4 years later, is $2.2 million. We serve kids that go to 91 schools and 31 cities, and we've ended homelessness for more than 800 kids and parents in Orange County. It's pretty awesome. Thank you, but that's a testament to getting out of God's way, to be super honest. That's not, I mean, I do my best every day, and I show up with everything that God has given me, but God's clearly driving the bus on this one because it's crazy town. But I will tell you, the learning curve was incredibly steep because at 42, I completely changed professions. I came into a profession where it's very networked. People have a lot of relationships. And I sort of just kept my head down as much as I could and tried to learn as much as I could. And so when I was asked to speak on reframing the future, I thought about what are the four things that I think are really critical for every social impact leader to really understand in order to reframe the future. And so the first one I would say is that we must be courageous. Maya D'Angelou said it is, courage is the most important of all virtues, because without courage, you can't practice any other virtue consistently. And it's absolutely true. So we have to show up with our full heart. And being followers of Christ, we have the opportunity to have an intersection of our spirit, our heart, and our brain in a way that is very powerful. And courage is neither an intellectual quality, nor can it be taught in a classroom. Now, we gain courage from personal risk-taking experiences, from multi-layered experiences in our life, and courage is fostered within us. It's not something that you can teach. It's not something that you can train someone to be courageous. There's a Buddhist monk, and I actually think this is a wonderful quote. The longest journey you will ever take is the 18 inches from your head to your heart. And I can tell you that the longest journey I ever took was from the Holy Spirit calling me to quit my job and me reconciling how in the world is it that I do this. I have $80,000 in law school debt. I have two children. I live in Newport Beach. My husband and I built, you know, our financial plan based on me contributing a certain amount of income. And then I sat there and I was like, you know what, I either believe God's promises or I don't. I either am going to be actively disobedient or I'm going to be obedient. And to be really transparent, I was way more terrified of being actively disobedient to God than I was, excited about being obedient. And that's just an admission because I was terrified. It took a lot of courage for me to be honest with myself, to look at what was preventing me from going in to what God was calling me to do, and I realized that it was fear, which is the opposite of courage. I was afraid that I wouldn't have enough money. I was afraid that I wouldn't have enough control. I was afraid that I wasn't going to know, quite candidly, what my future held for me because I had created this plan. And so it took courage for me to quit my job. It takes courage for you to wake up every morning and recommit to a cause that God has placed on your heart to fight strongly for. There's an article that will be passed out later that the Harvard Business Review just published that is on courage, basically calling out courage as the most important leadership characteristic. And being courageous doesn't mean that you're flippant about risk. Being courageous just means that you're honest and willing to go out and to dare greatly and to be in the arena. Even if you fail, you're doing the work that you believe you're being called to do. The second thing I would say, and especially coming from the private sector into the nonprofit sector, I see a desperate need for this. We must take risks. Quite candidly, if we don't take risks on behalf of children, sexually trafficked children, adults, whatever it is that we're being called into, no one is going to take risks on their behalf. And if we don't take risks now, we'll never have an opportunity to be innovative. We'll never have an opportunity to actually make transformative change, because sadly, if there's a 100% increase in student homelessness in America, what we're doing isn't working, people. Yeah. So we have to take risks to figure out what does work, and that means thinking outside of the box. Voltaire said that doubt is not a pleasant condition, but certainty is absurd. And I will say that that has been one of my life's mottos in the last 4 years, because it is really uncomfortable to not know exactly whether or not something's going to work, especially as a nonprofit leader when someone is investing in Project Hope to see the cycle of homelessness being broken. The uncertainty that I have to courageously be honest about when someone does invest requires a lot of courage, but when we start talking about that as leaders, when we start saying we have to take risks, now you take calculated risks, you take strategic risks, and you take, you know, smart risks, but we have to take risks. We have to actually build into our operating model funding and resources to pilot things to see if they work, to go ahead and test things. You know, we should be consistently testing and constantly testing our vision so that while we test it, we get better. We learn what doesn't work and we fail forward and we refine and we become stronger and better at what it is that we do. In that Lean Startup book, they talk about validated learning, which is that process of constantly refining, constantly testing. But you have to get out of your comfort zone to do that. And I really believe that the millennial generation is primely poised to start doing that work in a way that maybe no other generation has ever done it, just because of the way education is talking about failing forward, taking risks, and our understanding of risk assessment. And while we're taking risks, we're able to adjust before it's too late. We're able to pivot. If we get all the way to the end of a program and that's the first time we take a look to see if it's working, and then we realize that not only is it not working, but we're doing more damage, we failed everyone that we serve, and they can't afford that, and neither can we as a society. Now, a risk isn't worth taking unless you're able to learn from it. And what that means is, again, you have to build into your model risk-taking. You have to build into your model evaluation tools. You have to be able to make data-driven decisions, which requires you to build out some type of a platform to actually look at data and analyze it. Sometimes it's just as simple as partnering with someone who's getting a master's or a doctorate at a university that has to do some type of project. You can get, I mean, there are entire armies at universities that are not even taxed. Students that are looking for meaningful work to do and know how to do this type of work just because they've grown up, quite frankly, with all of this technology. The third thing that I would say is that we must come from a place of abundance. So if we truly believe that with God all things are possible, then we have to start at that point. We have to start by thinking that we can end the cycle of homelessness one child at a time, as far as Project Hope is concerned. And we have to think that in a perfect world, assuming we have all the resources we need, what is the very best that we can bring into the lives of our children and families to end that cycle? I've noticed that there is a tremendous culture of scarcity in the nonprofit and social impact world. And it has almost become something that people wear as a badge of honor, I would argue, to the detriment of their organizations. Now, I recognize resources are limited sometimes, but that doesn't mean that you have to start from a place of scarcity. You figure out with the resources that you have, what is the most impactful thing that you can do with them. And if you operate from a place of every person having incredible human capital instead of someone coming with a deficit, and you journey along because you know that that person has just as much worth and worthiness, and coming again from a faith-based perspective, Christ died on the cross equally for all of us. No one's fancier than anybody else. And so we have an opportunity to journey with the people that we walk alongside to harness that human capital. And we have a story to tell about how much invaluable human capital there is in our youth and our children to the business community. So I think that when we reject the deficit mentality and instead we take on a mentality of abundance, it changes the way we problem solve. It changes our willingness to take risks, to be courageous. And kind of like Mary Poppins says, anything can happen if you let it. Like, honestly, there is no practical reason why it is that I should be able to share with you that we've been able to end homelessness for that many folks in this short amount of time, other than the fact that with God, all things are possible. And we say as a team every day that we are going to come with the best that we can ever bring to our children. And we're going to reverse engineer the solution. What does the solution look like, assuming all things are possible? And how do we reverse engineer making that happen? But if you stop yourself by thinking, I'll never have enough resources, we'll never have enough intellectual capacity, infrastructure capacity, then you're already thinking small, just even in the design. And the fourth is that we must be strategic. We have to really stop and pause. We have to define what our white space is. What is it that we bring that is different than what others bring? You know, there are more nonprofits, I think, in Orange County than like any other place in the entire country. And if you Google, half of the nonprofits are doing the same thing and everyone's living in silos and nobody's talking to each other, which is what creates the scarcity mentality that there's these limited resources and like it's a pie, right? And there's only so much of the pie. So if somebody else comes into the pie that's a little bit left, that's absurd. It's total nonsense. And I think it's a lie from the pits of hell, quite frankly. Because we have a God that says that all things are possible. And so I don't believe in this pie idea. I believe in God's will being all defining. So we have to be strategic though. We have to sit down and be very thoughtful. We have to map out. So like one of the things that we did was we mapped out. Let's assume that a child is born into homelessness. From 0 to age 24, what are all the systems they come in contact with? Like get a whiteboard and just white it out. This is just an example from our organization. You know, they are born most likely in a hospital. Okay, so we know medical care comes in at birth. What does that look like? Map it out through all the different places. And then map out who's in the space to provide medical care for that kiddo from birth all the way to age 24. Education. We have the public education system. But there are failure points all along the way. Map those out. But look at it and look at where there are holes. Look at where there are needs that you've identified that are not being met and try to get in those spaces. Don't try to go into the space where someone's already doing something really well. You want to partner with them. And you want them to just crush the heck out of whatever it is that they're doing really well. And then you want to do the thing in the white space that nobody's doing. And so one of the critiques that I would say that the private sector places on the nonprofit sector is that we're not savvy enough. We don't build out operating models, we don't build out scale models, and we don't know what kind of infrastructure we need. So really, one of the challenges for me this last year was I needed to know that if I met someone in the store and they said, "Hey Jen, my name's Sally, here's $1 million, what are you gonna do with it?" I know exactly what to do with it. Because I'm not operating from a scarcity mentality, I'm operating from a mentality of abundance. So I'm assuming all things being possible, how would we scale the organization with the three programs that we have that no one else is in that space? And so we spent a year and we looked at what all of our overhead costs were, we had lever triggers, what's capacity, when do we have to make a new hire, what do those new hires look like, what would that cost, and then we put it into this awesome cheat sheet that shows over the next 3 years, Project Hope scaling under a conservative, moderate, and aggressive model, what does it cost without any admin, per child, per school, and per family, and what does it cost all things in the mix, per child, per school, and per family. And so we now have that. And so I would challenge, and it's gonna look different at different stages, right? But really be thoughtful and know what you would do with $1 million if somebody came and gave it to you. And like really know. Not like, well, we'd serve more kids or we'd serve more families. No, we would scale into these three schools geographically. We've done the research. And again, it sounds more overwhelming than it is if you just take it step by step. But you will learn things in the process that are absolutely mission critical. And we have to be able to identify the partners and the audiences that we need to work together with in order to achieve shared results. We have lots of partners that have the same shared results that we have. I'll give you an example, like Grad Nation. They want to make sure that opportunity youth graduate from high school. Project Hope. We know that only 25% of homeless youth graduate from high school. We have a shared goal. So what do they have that they can bring to us that we can then leverage and serve our kids more effectively and more efficiently? So we need to know our partners and our audiences. And when we get together with them, we have to really clarify what those shared measurables are, identify people who aren't at the table that need to be at the table. Always be thinking cross-sector partnerships. If we just hang out, it's sort of like Christ didn't just hang out with Christians. Otherwise, how would we ever share the gospel? Don't just hang out with the people you already know who are already in that space. You need to get out. You know, if you have at your organization sometimes a need to rent a car from Enterprise, then you need to hook up with Enterprise because you need to not be spending that money on renting cars and let Enterprise give you a car and then you put the money towards something that you don't have a partner to provide. So we have to really know in that mapping out process what it is, who those partners are, and then find ways to get in front of them. And part of that is also determining the types of skills and competencies. So we at Project Hope are a data-driven organization, which is like mumbo-jumbo, really. Everybody says all these words, collective impact, data-driven. Then you ask them what it means, and they're like, I don't know. So I'll tell you what it means to us. It means that we use data to drive programming instead of fundraising. If we build a really great program and it gets really great results, people are going to want to invest in it. If we have data and our analytics purpose and the why behind our analytics is to make sure people think it's really great so they give us money. We have no idea if what we're doing works at all. And again, we could be doing more harm than we're doing good. And that's very dangerous. So I would just encourage all of you to really, you know, be courageous, to take risks, to come from a place of abundance, and to be strategic. And if you do that, you will find that God's promises are incredibly true. And you also will find where it is you're being called into, as opposed to, like, I have to put Jennifer Friend to the side all the time. I'm constantly trying to say, what is it that I want to do versus what is it that God wants to do, and make sure that I'm not leading Project Hope, but God is. And so hopefully this is helpful. It's just a little bit of what I've learned. And so thank you all for being out there and fighting the good fight.